Right now on KCCI 8 News Close Up, Iowa's 4th District Republican Congressman Steve King. This morning we'll talk with him about key issues facing Congress and the threat from North Korea and his recent trip to Tanzania. KCCI 8 News Close Up starts right now.
This is Iowa's news leader. This is KCCI 8 News Close Up.
And good morning. Thank you for joining us for Close Up. This morning, our guest is Republican Congressman Steve King. King covers Iowa's 4th District, which covers 39 counties and the cities of Ames, Fort Dodge, Mason City, Sioux City, and Spencer. The congressman is currently serving his 8th term in the U.S. House of Representatives. He serves on the House Agriculture, Judiciary, and Small Business Committees. Thank you so much, Congressman, for joining us this morning.
Happy to be here.
So you were recently have returned from a trip to Tanzania. Tell us briefly how you came to be there.
Well, it was a request that came from Dr. Steve Meyer, an orthopedic surgeon who spends half of each year roughly in Tanzania with mission work, his pro bono surgery work, and he runs an orphanage and a school. And he called me and said, "Steve, I need a miracle. There's been a tragic bus accident in Tanzania, and out of the 38 people on the bus, almost all of them children, there are only 3 survivors. 3 children survived who were in the back of the bus when the bus went off the road, and 3 of Dr. Meyer's volunteers were behind that bus. They pulled the survivors out, and they pulled those out who did not survive. And they concluded, Dr. Meyer concluded, that the 3 survivors would not live in Tanzania. He needed to get them back to Sioux City if they were going to survive. And he said, "I need visas, I need passports, I need a medevac plane. And we've got the rest covered." So that was the request, and I went to work with that. The visas and the passports were the easier part. Mm-hmm. The medevac plane was the most difficult. But I worked through 5 different U.S. embassies throughout the Balkans in the European area. And in the end, the answer came this way. Conversation after who knows how many phone calls with Reverend Franklin Graham of Samaritan's Purse. And he said, "We want to help," meaning Samaritan's Purse wants to help. He had a DC-8 that he would fly those children out of Africa. And I said, "Reverend, I don't know if I can raise the money for that." And he said, "You won't need to, we'll take care of it." And those children were flown back to Sioux City, where all their medical care was donated by volunteers. And the serious surgery went to work on those 3 children. And the dream then was even Doreen, who was paralyzed from the waist down, would walk off of that plane onto their native soil in Tanzania. That happened last Friday.
That happened.
And Marilyn and I were there to greet them.
How wonderful. What was it about this case? Why get involved with this case?
Well, there are a lot of tragedies around the world.
Yes.
And so I don't know that we can just look across and pick and choose, but sometimes you just get a calling. And this was one of those times. And in my case, it came in the form of a phone call from Dr. Meyer. And I knew from the conviction in his voice and from other projects that we've worked on, he's my pheasant hunting buddy. I know his heart. I know his faith. I know about his mission project in Tanzania. I knew that he was going to pull out all the stops to get this done. And I knew also that I was in a position to help. And this time, because I was, we came together. What I did was only one link in a chain of miracles. But in the end, Dr. Meyer was the linchpin for the chain of miracles.
Well, it indicates truly how small the world can be. Mm-hmm. Isn't that true? And you have been so emotionally moved by this and touched by this whole experience and the way everything came together. And the fact that that child could walk off the plane is simply amazing, and amazing to be a part of that, I'm sure.
And we're put in our places in this life for a reason. This was one of the reasons. And I can't say enough about all of the people that were part of this chain of miracles that brought it together. But I know that when Doreen was paralyzed from the waist down, and I visited them in the hospital after the surgery, among those 3 children, they had 5 of 6 arms were broken, 4 of 6 legs broken, 2 of 3 spines fractured, 1 of 3 jaws fractured, 25 fractures altogether, along with lacerations. And when Dr. Meyer and his team put them all back together, we didn't expect that Doreen would walk again. But he called me one day about 2 weeks later on a Sunday, and he said, "I want to tell you about another miracle." I walked by Doreen's bed and I teased her a little bit, and she kicked me.
Hey.
And that's when he said, "They will walk off that plane." and we decided we were going to be there to greet them.
Wonderful story. Wonderful story. I want to take a look and ask you about a tweet that you sent out after you left Tanzania. Some folks were kind of wondering what your meaning was behind this. So explain. Explain what you meant with this tweet.
Well, you know, I have a bit of an ironic sense of humor.
Okay.
And so this is a long travel schedule, and I'm checking things and watching what's going on. And we actually were watching the eclipse out of the window of the plane. Mm-hmm. And so when I found this picture, I thought, oh, this will just be a good thing to toss out there to get people to think a little bit. I wanted to bring the attention again to the Tanzanian miracle children. It was a chance to put that forward out on a Twitter account that goes out to, you know, thousands of people, and to get them to think about it a little bit. And then I just thought the irony of Harambe being up there in the eclipse that way was, and coming out of Africa and seeing the eclipse, it all just fit.
Okay. Okay, and we've got so many other topics to touch on today, and so I've got to move on from that, the Tanzania piece, to talk about maybe what has happened in Charlottesville, Virginia, still fresh on people's minds, sensitive time in the country. Wondering what your reaction to the president's response was when he said there's blame to be shared on both sides. Mm-hmm. What did you think about that?
Well, I was out of the country when this happened, so I did not and have not seen the videos of that as it unfolded. But I'm under the understanding that the group that carried the white banner, however they labeled themselves, had a permit to demonstrate. They were counter-demonstrators. I don't have any evidence that they had a permit to demonstrate. There was a clash apparently in the streets. I don't know who landed the first blow. But it's a tragedy in any case, the lady losing her life down there. And it looks to me that when the president said there was blame on both sides, the facts do support the president's statement. And I think that we should step back and look at things objectively. This has gotten completely out of hand. We're not a nation that should be pitted against each other down the lines of race or ethnicity or national origin or any of these distinctions that are distinct to us. And so when I see these demonstrations around the country, when I see them tearing history down, I think, why would we go to these kind of ends here when there's so much that we need to do to pull each other together, so much progress we need to make together? This country is more divided than I remember it since the Vietnam War demonstrations. Mm-hmm. And I'm very saddened by that. And I don't know if we have the right force in this country to pull us back together if the people fail themselves to do so. So I'd say, let's put that stuff behind us in history. The Civil War was history. The Confederacy was history. There's a symbol there that means slavery to some, but it means an historical pride in the South to others. And we should be able to look at it as history. It hasn't been a problem for 150 years. Why it emerges now looks to me like it's politically driven.
So people should fly the Confederate flag if they choose to fly the Confederate flag.
Well,
they should be allowed to.
I'm not recommending that.
Okay.
But you know, here's another way to think about this, and that is that in 1989 there was a case before the United States Supreme Court, and the court on a 5-4 split decision decided that burning the flag was freedom of speech. In Germany, it's against the law to present or display and perhaps even to own a swastika. I remember saying to the Germans, if you have to outlaw a symbol that you dislike, what does that do to your freedom of speech, thought, and expression? You can never be a free people if you're going to outlaw free expression. And yet, I have to watch a flag be burned when someone wants to demonstrate that because the Supreme Court has ruled that a constitutional right. The Germans can't have a swastika, and now we're in a position where the Confederate flag or the symbols of the Confederacy are being pulled down around America, regardless of what they mean to people. If that is ever all done, and it never ends, by the way, there's always another symbol, there's always another example that somebody's going to object to. But throughout all of that, even if the left achieves what they're trying to do, we're all going to be watching somebody burn an American flag. And it's got to stop. It makes no sense, and it's irrational to be picking certain symbols if they're not willing to accept essentially all of them. And in other words, here's another piece of irony.
Well, I think we might have to take a break, sir.
Okay.
Unless you want to finish your thought very quickly.
I would be happy to. No, let's take the break and come
okay.
back.
Okay.
Okay.
There's
it might be
so much to talk about today.
Okay.
Our conversation continues with Congressman King right after the break. Now, welcome back to Close Up. Our guest is Congressman Steve King. Let's talk about health care. Senator Ernst said this week she believes that Republicans have to abandon the repeal and replace Obamacare in one big piece of legislation and instead approach it in bite-sized pieces. Do you agree with that?
Well, I've long advocated for the full 100% standalone repeal of Obamacare. And I regret that we didn't bring that bill in the first week of January this year. Had the Speaker allowed that to happen to the floor of the House, every Republican would have voted for the full repeal. We might have been able to find a way to force a vote in the Senate. And I know that there's a 60 vote filibuster level there. Had we done that, it would have been a lot easier to negotiate the things we need to do to repair the health insurance system in the country. So I voted for a number of changes to Obamacare that were incremental fixes to it. I will vote for more if we can get there. But it's a real shame that we've been able to push this thing this long and this hard. And I think the biggest mistake made with the strategy that came out of Republican leadership clear back 8 years ago now was to tie the word replace with the word repeal. When you say repeal and replace, that implies a package. And I argue throughout that entire time, take the and replace away from repeal, win the repeal argument, let's do that. We've got a whole list of things we want to do to reform the healthcare system that we had before Obamacare was passed. But I don't know that next step forward now, and I don't know that anybody does, and I don't see it emerging from the strategy of the session, of the Senate, excuse me. And September 5th, we'll be back in session in the House, and then we'll see if anybody has good ideas. I will sign the discharge petition that will bring the full repeal of Obamacare to the floor of the House. That's, I think, the next step if we can get that done. And then there are many things we want to do to repair and reform the healthcare system in the country. But I regret so much that Iowans are put in the position that we are in because of the inability to be able to make a decision in Congress. I haven't had a problem with it. My decisions are clear. People know where I stand. But Congress couldn't get together, and I do regret that, and I'm hopeful that we'll find a way.
Okay. Now, what are your thoughts on, as Congress negotiates a new spending plan for the next fiscal year, would you like to see a border wall funding in there? The president has said last night, I believe, recently in Phoenix, that if there was no border wall, he would be okay with a shutdown.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think?
Well, it's interesting. I had a conversation into some of the White House leadership just within a short period of time ago. And also with some of the other press. And I've said this, I support that $1.6 billion for a border wall. I would pile another $4 or $5 billion on there. Let's get it built, quickly. But the president's ask is $1.6 billion, and it's a reasonable request when he says if we have to go through a government shutdown to fund the border wall. I think it's a good strategic statement for him to make, and the timing of it was right, and the location was right in Phoenix. And I don't think we will come to any government shutdown. I don't think the president will need to veto a bill. If he signals that the bill shall have the funding in it for the border wall, then Republicans cannot serve him something that they vote for that he would veto, knowing in the end that he will get his way. So let's give him his $1.6 billion and get on with the mandate from the American people that they called for when they elected Donald Trump as president.
Well, right now it seems the president and a number of members of his own party seem to be at loggerheads, kind of not getting along as well as they could be or should be, specifically his relationship with Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell. I'm wondering what you think about that.
Well, I don't want to be critical of Mitch McConnell on this, although I don't agree with some of the things that he pushes, and I don't always agree with the president either. But the dynamics of this I would characterize in a broader way. Mitch McConnell's trying to hold a conference together, the Republicans in the Senate, and he knows he's got to negotiate to pick up 8 votes from the Democrats to get the big things done. But the dynamics are really nationwide, and it's more this, that Democrats have gotten together and decided they won't provide a single vote or a bit of help to repeal, replace, or reform Obamacare.
Are they being invited to? Are they being asked to? Are they being asked for their, because they are saying they're not. You're a member of that body, so you know whether they are or not. Are they being asked?
The reason I'm smiling is because I talk to them all the time.
Okay.
If they had any interest, they would say, hey, I've got an idea here.
Okay.
Can we do some work? Instead, I hear, you guys are on your own. you guys are on your own. We wash our hands of that. You're going to repeal it. You're going to do that on your own. If you're going to replace it, you're going to do that on your own. I hear it constantly. I believe that they sat down sometime in November or December and made that agreement among themselves. But I'm not suggesting that somehow they're all to blame for this. These are partisan disagreements and they're ideological disagreements. But the bigger problem is among Republicans who have the votes, if we got together, to make these changes, we have disagreement as well. And that's a core of never-Trumpers, people that decided they'll never support Donald Trump, and they don't want to see his agenda move. And they're the ones that are holding this back, as well as the Democrats that we'll get no help from. Well, so that's the reality we have.
Can the Republican Party come together and join the president to get his legislative agenda accomplished?
I hope so.
Okay.
But I gave a speech to my Republican conference. This was behind closed doors, first week in January. And I said, you know, we've argued over splitting hairs on legislation for 8 years under the Obama administration. But we wanted to get the best kind of legislation that we believe is right throughout that period of time. And we knew he'd veto our legislation. Now we've got to get things done. We can't be arguing over minutiae. We've got to move an agenda forward, and we need to move the Trump agenda forward. And every week bring something and move it, and set aside our differences among ourselves. We don't have that level of agreement among our conference today, and the thing I fear it has come to pass, we're bogged down. And we've got to figure out how to inject that momentum in. Hopefully we can find a big win. Maybe it's on tax reform.
Okay, we'll get to that right after this break. My next question. And welcome back. Right before the break, you talked about comprehensive tax reform. So what are the prospects for that this year?
They would be a lot better if we had resolved the Obamacare issue, or if we find a way to do that. But I've been working with some of the top economists in the country, Art Laffer, for example. I brought him in as a speaker, and he's been a guest in my office, along with Stephen Moore and Larry Kudlow. Steve Forbes is ready to step in also. I'd say they're the top four economists that I listen to in the country. There's a consensus among them that if we can just move corporate tax reform. We have the highest corporate income tax of the developed nations in the world. And we're losing the domicile of major American companies that are going overseas. Ireland, for example, has over 700 formerly American companies that are domiciled in Ireland because of tax reasons. So if we can cut our corporate tax down to, they'd like to go to 15%. I would support that. I don't know if we can hold 15. If we can repatriate the trillions of dollars that are stranded overseas because of the tax implications, and if we can address the estate tax, and I would abolish it, but if we can amend it in a significant way, that could be the stimulator that can get our growth back to above 3%, where it historically has been, except for the last 9 years.
I need to jump to another subject already. North Korea. It's scaring a lot of people. People are really nervous about what's going on over there, what the president wants to do to handle it. What's the answer?
Well, from an Iowa perspective, I'd like to send a message over to Ambassador Branstad. And it's a big ask, but he's got a great relationship with the leadership in China. And I think China is the only country, other than perhaps the forces are there in North Korea, to bring about a regime change in North Korea. That's the best way that I can see that we can avoid a conflict and death and destruction. But it does look like Kim Jong-un has blinked over the Guam issue, and so maybe this thing can be tamped down. But we know now they're a nuclear power. And I want to see that ended. I don't want to live in a world perpetually with North Korea, nuclear power, and irrational, perhaps, nuclear power, and Iran emerging as a nuclear power. Those two things put this globe at great risk. And it's going to take bold leadership to resolve that. And I'm not privy to all of the strategic components of this. I haven't sat in on a classified briefing that goes deeply into what we think North Korea's capabilities are. But it's a very, very dangerous situation. At least the rhetoric has been tamped down a little bit over the last week or so. Maybe we can just leave it parked there until there's a regime change in North Korea.
And very quickly, your thoughts on the president's stance now on Afghanistan. Some folks said there weren't enough details in his speech on Monday night. Your thoughts?
Well, I've sat on the border between Afghanistan and Pakistan, and I've discussed and had open meetings with the Pakistani military right there in some of those areas. When he said that Pakistan will not be a sanctuary, and he's going to call on Pakistan and especially on the Afghan military to do more, take more responsibility, we'll provide more training, put some more troops there to support that. I'm going to be with the president on this decision. First thing is, he's got access to more information than we have. We have new commanders that he's listening to. And our Secretary of Defense, Mattis, for example, he's a brilliant man with a sharp eye on strategy. So I'm hopeful that this can emerge as something that eventually the Afghans can hold. But we have never done well if we allowed sanctuary for our enemies. And if Pakistan would continue as a sanctuary for the Taliban and our enemies there, then I don't know if you ever end that in Afghanistan. So we need to get it to where they can handle it. And it looks to me like his advisors believe that can be done. We have a lot of experience there. I'm hopeful that it succeeds.
All right. Thank you. We'll be right back. We will wrap up our conversation next. And we are wrapping up our conversation with Republican Congressman Steve King. Before you go, I'd like to talk a little bit about Steve Bannon. We understand he's been ousted from the White House, was senior counsel to the president, but you went to bat for him to try to keep him in his role. Mm-hmm. Why?
Well, because I see the strategist that he is. I've known him for years, going back into the Breitbart.com when that was first formed. When he came on board Breitbart, I got to know him then when he was filming a movie, as when we first met. And I've sat with him for hours and discussed the history and culture and civilization and the American experience and the dynamics that move this. And he understands this deeply. And so I wanted his voice in the West Wing of the White House as close to the president as possible. But I just spoke with him just shortly before I came in the studio here. And he's optimistic about going back to Breitbart and being able to operate freely there. He's in full-throated 100% support of the president. And the agenda that the president was elected on and the mandate that the president received from the American people. So if he's not discouraged by this move, but encouraged by this move, I'm going to go with Steve Bannon's attitude and think that his judgment is good enough that being on the outside, he'll be more effective than he has been on the inside. And so I'll say this, that he came aboard the Trump campaign in order to save the Trump campaign. And I think that he has stepped out of the White House to go back to Breitbart.com because he can do the most to assist the president there.
There were reports that when he left the White House, he said, okay, folks, we're at war. Did that really happen? Did he say that?
Let's see. I think one of the editors at Breitbart sent a tweet out,
okay.
Hashtag war.
Yeah.
I do think that happened. But
Who would he be at war with?
Well, I can say with authority, not with the president. And I think there are some forces there in the White House.
Or his daughter, Ivanka,
Well, there are forces there that he disagrees with, I'm sure. And that's been a public discussion that's taken place. But I've been concerned that the conservatives in the West Wing have been leaving that West Wing one after another. And now I look at Kellyanne Conway, she's a terrific friend. She's done my polling for a dozen years. And I know what she's made of. And she needs more solid conservatives around her. That's something that I lament, the pressure that will come on Kellyanne.
Thank you for joining us. We're always short on time when we get